You've reached The Signal Watch, movies, television, comics, and more. I'm your host, Ryan Steens. Join me and our cadre of co-contributors as we examine cultural artifacts of the 20th century, boldly explore the 21st, and try to put it all in perspective. Stay tuned. We're gonna try to make this work. Last time on The Signal Watch.
If you're listening to this, we're going to assume that you have already seen these movies right. And are looking to us for astute analysis.
So one of the things I want to bring up is a concept I have in my head, and I call it the Space Jam fallacy.
I mean, who among us hasn't broken into a mansion and met a wolfman that we befriended with a magical 80s water slide?
It does function extremely well as a music video, because Helen Slater's hot.
Well, this actually gives me my segue to my half page of notes about why Lloyd sucks.
This movie totally makes sense when you consider the fact that Billie Jean and Binks are killed by a gator attack in the beginning of the movie, and that the rest of it is a death hallucination.
So this is one of the things that I love about this movie. It's a road movie that doesn't go anywhere.
Oh, I'm so nerdy and so quirky, and I'm going to keep saying how weird I am.
Binks, don't you ever lack anything other than vanilla?
And now, The Signal Watch returns with part two of Teens in Revolt, The Legend of Billie Jean, and Pump Up the Volume.
Everybody knows that the dice are loaded. Everybody rolls with their fingers crossed. Everybody knows the war is over. Everybody knows the good guys lost. Everybody knows the fight was fixed. The poor stay poor, the rich get rich. That's how it goes. Everybody knows.
We have a whole other movie to talk about. We do. Also about teen rebellion. And with that, I have packs of blackjack gum. I'm going to grab
Is it time? I'm not going to do that.
It's time. I'm also going to get out my Lucky Lights candy cigarettes.
I definitely need to have
Where's my candy? Cherry one of the, Pepsi?
I looked for it, but not that hard because it's not that good. Yeah, now have my official...
Now you get to listen to us... chew gum. That's fantastic. Looks like not a cigarette at all.
So I want to, before we talk about this, maybe I want to talk about the context in which I first saw it. At age 15, I was transplanted from Austin, Texas to Spring, Texas, where I met these two fine people.
Yes.
This movie came out a week after I moved to Spring, Texas, and I saw it at the Lowe's where Marshall worked in high school.
Yeah.
The year before that, before we moved, my brother had decided he was going to start a pirate radio station.
Oh!
And so we had gone to the Austin Public and checked out books on how one does this and found out it's super illegal and they will hunt you down like a dog. They do not want people messing with the airwaves. See, pretty much that is what ham radio was for and, you know, other kinds of radio. But if you got onto like the FM dial, they were going to track you down unless you were broadcasting within a 3-block radius. That was, I think, the legal limit. So that was the context in which I went into this movie, fully believing that when I got into school the first week, I would meet Samantha Mathis. I was sorely, sorely disappointed.
You didn't meet Samantha Mathis over and over and over again?
No.
Manic pixie dream girl?
No. And I will say also...
She definitely is that.
I didn't really have like a big like crush on like movie stars or actors or any of that. Mm-hmm. But she was my first like kind of around my age. Like I just watched Pump Up the Volume over and over just to watch Samantha Mathis growing up. And not just because of surprise boobs.
Surprise boobs.
Yeah.
We're going to talk more about that. But I want you... Are you done talking about the...
I have more to say about Samantha Mathis, but I'm going to save it for a separate podcast where I'm just going to talk into a microphone for about an hour.
We should talk more about Samantha Mathis in this podcast. I figured with Helen Slater and Samantha
Mathis... These candy cigarettes are not good.
A point in time where I have to sit back and listen to you guys talk. So we can do that. That's fine. Okay. But I will say this.
I don't know.
Do we look cool? Very cool. Guys, smoking is cool as it turns out. Everyone go back to smoking.
No, it looks like you guys have really thick lollipop sticks in your mouth. This is kind of the kind of radio which is like, why we wouldn't like me describe.
Long story short, candy cigarettes are not very realistic. Yes.
So I do have a question. This has sometimes come up, like, with men and how they act and how they're like, but they're hot. Like, I feel like that was, like, in past podcasts, like a Fifty Shades of Grey situation. But, like, Samantha Mathis is kind of stalking him. But she is very attractive.
Samantha Mathis was not going to have a trouble finding a guy at her school. I mean, I know they say, oh, they're all nerds here or whatever. Samantha Mathis would have been the girl going downtown to clubs and like, had the creepy relationship with a guy who was, like,
30. I wasn't sure if that was really around there and where they are in the desert. Which is part of the sense of place for this.
Yeah, I was reading it as a suburb of Phoenix, even when I saw it as a kid. I mean, there's major street signs, and you know, they're not.
It's not a small town in the middle of the desert, but.
Small towns in the desert tend to be way grimier and grosser than that.
I don't think it's a suburb.
Yeah.
But I didn't know how much was available in the bigger town close by. I mean, you might know more than...
Phoenix has got a punk scene. It's the sixth biggest city in the country. People do not know this.
Well, then that is... Yes, I didn't know that about Phoenix. Yeah. I mean, I figured, yes.
It'd be Paragon just like someone going to, like, I'm going to Numbers, or I'm going to Fitzgerald.
I was
going to
say, Houston was the fourth biggest city in the... Right?
Yeah.
Like, but that was the difference... Well, not a difference. Like, we grew up in the suburbs, but I felt like as soon as there was a car, like, we were trying to get downtown as often as we could.
Yeah. And cute girls who didn't have cars did not have a hard time...
Finding somebody to drive them.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's true.
And so that to me, all red flags. As a 15-year-old who was not going to be super good about making friends right out of the gate when I got to high school, learning to talk to people I didn't know was something I figured out in college, like after college. So that appealed to me a lot. Mm-hmm. I really believed, you know, as far as fantasy movies go, I was going to whip off my glasses and be happy Harry hard on, taken to the radio waves or whatever, since I didn't have any equipment, writing busily on, you know, notebook pads. It's a very appealing fantasy, I think, for everybody, which everyone has tried to live out thanks to the power of Twitter.
And podcasting,
yeah.
I think that's what the story of both of these movies is. They're doing something that's kind of hard that is ubiquitous now. This, like, becoming famous on the strength of my own personal broadcast, that should have been emphasized more in The Legend of Billie Jean, but that is exactly what Pump Up the Volume does. It is... the one-man content machine screaming into the void and building an audience, and that's his story. And that what makes it, I think, powerful is that he's good at it. And you can see in the movie why he would obtain a following, especially given the kind of what he's doing and what he's speaking about. That's why we paired these. That's why these movies go so well together. But it is interesting that he's doing something that would have been not only difficult, but is... very, very illegal. If you're wondering at the end when the FCC start trying to find him, that's, I don't know if they would have tried to do it like that. They would have actually found him and stopped him much more easily.
Yeah. According to the books I read when I was 14.
Yeah, they would have found him, stopped him, arrested him, and he would have paid at minimum a heavy fine.
Yes.
For what, this is why you don't hear pirate radio very much in America, and didn't then. The reason you don't hear it now is because nobody needs it. Everybody has alternate things.
Yeah. Pirate radio was really a thing that happened over the Mexican border into the border states, or maybe out of Canada, but that's where Wolfman Jack got his start, was Mexican radio.
Great song.
And there's a lot of pirate radio in England, right? Wasn't that like a whole scene for a while? I feel like.
Well, there's that movie about the boat.
Offshore, right?
You can go offshore. And there you're literally competing against the government. So that's a very...
I'm going to throw something on the table that I know will not be liked. Okay. If you watch this now, he sounds a lot like Alex Jones.
No, actually, I agree with you. Or I think that is kind of what happened. Like, it's like this idea that we're gonna get rid of censorship and we're opening up the floodgates, but now we have opened up the floodgates, and
Having had kind of grown up in Austin, having gone to college in Austin, Alex Jones was originally on, you know him now from InfoWars and his various scandals that are now kind of cropping up, but he was on basic cable on Austin Community Access when we were in college, and the thing to do was to drink beer and watch Alex Jones and have a good laugh, because here was this guy ranting and raving, but you also felt like he was deeply contained, because it was like him and his five friends who did the show kind of going and harassing like local news people, and it was all
hilarious. I definitely
laughed
at him a lot that I regret now.
Yeah. Then he got an AM radio show, and then it was an FM radio show, and then the internet happened, and he could stream live. And if you listen, one of the things that watching this movie, when I watched it 10 years ago, when I kind of turned on it, honestly, was I don't know what he's saying. I have no idea what Happy Heart On is saying, other than I have teen angst.
I had the same problem with Fight Club, right? This is the fight. I have a lot of vague complaints about society, but they're basically content free.
I wanted to talk about that.
What am I so upset about
here? And I don't know that I totally buy that he is Alex Jones, but there is this sort of like, I'm a teenager, I have angst, and like, I'm just mad because there's nothing to rebel, like, I'm literally a rebel without a cause, and you guys took sex and rock and roll, and I'm bummed out because my dad's a sellout. And then there are these things that happen in the movie that are more serious. Mm-hmm. But a lot, I mean, I appreciate that he has the conversation with the gay kid and how that's mm-hmm. handled. I appreciate the conversation with the kid who's having the suicide ideation, no matter how they ultimately end up handling that. You know, there is this sort of, like, education thing that's, mm-hmm. like, a real concern. But a lot of what he's complaining about is just, like, nobody gets me.
Yeah. They pitch it as this thing that teenagers are really going to glom onto. And I don't know. I can only go from my own brain when I would have been that age. I know this message resonated with me then. Because yeah. I had no problem with it, and that, I mean, I didn't go, screw this guy.
I mean, that is a real teenager feeling, right?
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, I don't know, how realistic it is for a bunch of high schoolers to drive onto the high school's football field, and, you know, that alone right there, fantasy movie. They would have been guarding that grass like crazy. And
sort of. Well, I guess that's true, but it reminded me of Dazed and Confused a little bit, mm-hmm. with all the kids getting together and playing their stereos, and,
I just don't think it would have happened on the school football field. They were protecting that grass like crazy.
Can I say something funny about that scene when it first happens? The girl is Layla Slotman, and her boyfriend is played by Ahmet Zappa, and they're actually cousins. Mm-hmm. But the punk guy turns, they pull up to listen. Punk guy turns to them and goes, "Yuppies."
Yeah.
And I think that's funny because they're Zappas. That's all. Just an extra layer.
It was also a weird call out because stylistically,
they're not really.
Yeah, like there are those guys who show up in those horrible sweaters with mm-hmm. the button down collars. Those are the yuppies. Mm-hmm. And it almost felt like that cut was should have been to about somebody else mm-hmm. showing up, and they just used it there or something. Right. But I don't remember enough about the scene to remember if there was a cut or whether they did that in a zoom or pan or something. Right. But anyway, I don't want to get that nitpicky.
No.
I'm going down a rabbit hole. I absolutely should not. I had thought initially that the studio had pressured him into adding on the principal storyline.
Hmm.
But in reading about it last night, that's not true. Apparently the same thing happened at Alan Moyle wrote and directed this movie. It was actually pretty independent, but released, I believe, by New Line.
Mm-hmm.
And
Bano was released by New Line.
Yeah, and he apparently that happened at his sister's school where she was teaching.
Yeah,
and I was like, this all sounds fantastic. Like, what? Who wouldn't notice in the burbs if
actually I feel like it happens
scandals like this, right? If you're not showing up, like the only way. Even now, you're getting credit for butts in the seat. The only way you get them off your roll is if they're actually not attending your school anymore. Mm-hmm. Like they're out. Mm-hmm. And if it wasn't then, it's even more so now. Mm-hmm. Your schools are based almost entirely on test scores.
Mm-hmm.
And there's immense pressure. I mean, we had the cheating scandal, you remember, mm-hmm. where they're actually going in and changing the answers for the students to raise the scores. That part felt very realistic to me. If anything, it belatedly gave his his radio show more of a thrust than it initially has, because you're right, I think when we first start hearing him, we're like, what is your message? Mm-hmm. Other right. than I'm telling the truth, other than as a confessional, this is my life, this is what I'm doing.
Mm-hmm. He does find the note about yeah. Cheryl, so yeah. there's...
Right, yeah. later becomes a little bit of a, I'm in a sort of an investigative reporter, kind mm-hmm. of, like I'm revealing this really stuff.
But I feel like the movie has a really hard, and then why I felt it was tacked on in studio pressure is... He kind of deals with that, kind of not. He never really interacts with the principal himself. Even the scene that Nora has with the principal is something she relates that we don't see. She just tells us, which is really weird for a movie. And it's hilarious why she's kicked out of school. She's yeah. like, I'm failing math. And I was like, oh... So she has low SAT scores and she's failing yeah. math? She's a dummy. Like...
She may not be a dummy, but...
She's a dummy.
Oh.
Yeah.
It's not very realistic. I remember the high school that I went to, that we all went to. Mm-hmm. All the pretty kids were also smart. They were generally also the smart.
That's not true.
that was true. For me, that was true.
I mean, there were pretty smart kids, and there were also pretty kids that were maybe... That may have been.
I didn't find... know the dumb pretty ones. I just...
we'll talk later.
You got enough yearbooks to identify the right. dumb dumbs.
I haven't...
share her?
I don't know. It's been a long time since I looked at your book. But actually, I feel like this sort of happened at our school, too. I mean, not to the level that it was like they were doing anything illegal, but, you know, there are kids that get... They were picking on the kids that didn't have parents who were going to show up and, like, advocate for them. They weren't picking on, like, Paige, you know, with the rich dad.
I have a whole other thing about Paige.
I know, yeah. Me too. But, like, one of the kids that gets kicked out is Luis Chavez. Then there's, like, a pregnant kid that gets kicked out. Like, the one Hispanic kid gets kicked out of the school.
The punk kid gets kicked out.
The names when they're reading at the end of who got kicked out is like, oh, this is why there's nobody who's not white in this movie. Yeah.
But I also feel like in our school, the kids that were maybe getting kicked out, dropping out, sent to, like, an alternative school were maybe kids that didn't have somebody to advocate for them, that maybe weren't always getting the best... I think if they had done those same things and were, like, one of the really smart kids. Like, I don't know that I would have identified it as white privilege at the time, but I knew by my senior year I could do pretty much whatever I want. I had already been coded as a good, smart kid, and they were going to let me go wherever I wanted in the school.
Marshall, you got, like, suspended or something right before graduation.
I got suspended multiple times.
Really?
Yes. And I was the only kid in the top 10% of our class who was not in National Honor Society, which is voted upon by teachers. So,
yeah.
No, Marshall, what were you up to?
Marshall told the tardy lady, what are you going to do? You're the tardy lady. and he was about to deliver our commencement address.
You are Nora in this.
Yes.
Like, you're like,
you're pretty in dumb.
Like, I literally almost got, because I was about to deliver the commencement address, but I was like...
They had a kill switch on Marshall at our graduation.
It wouldn't surprise me if they did that going forward.
I had a very well-written speech, which is why I got to give it. Mm-hmm. I was not the valedictorian or the salutatorian.
Right.
You had to try out.
That's
to
not how it. They did it at our
so
school.
So they let me be the Christian Slater. This is what spoke to me about the movie, is that I was the kid whose teachers liked him because I did well in my compositions.
Right.
And, you know, and they liked that. Mm-hmm. And that, writ large, that's a theme of this movie, is that... You bring it up Alex Jones is right, because I think one of the things that we've seen in this country is that when you talk about talk radio and who owns talk radio, it isn't these liberal wish fulfillment fantasies.
Right.
Talk radio is owned by disaffected white conservatives and nutcases. Mm-hmm. That's the audience for talk radio in our mm-hmm. country. But in this story, this is a very much boomer wish fulfillment thing, where you literally see the appreciative boomers sitting around the radio listening while they're drinking their expensive
cool
liquor
teacher.
And wine. Yeah, this is funny. I'm enjoying these kids and their crazy antics on the radio.
And I love the dick jokes.
That's not crazy. I had teachers who did that, who were like very into the kids and the mildly subversive right. English Yeah, future English major, which is what I was. This movie spoke to me as the guy who got in trouble for dumb shit and but was good in school.
Right.
I will argue this movie, though, when you watch it from through a certain lens, is, I think, kind of Gen Xer twist from what the boomers were up to with kind of liberalism as it turns into libertarianism.
Yeah.
Of he's rejected his, you know, the hippies disappointed us. Everyone's disappointed us. We're on our own. It's up to us to make it happen. Whether I'm going to recognize this whole system that's supporting me and making sure I get by day by day in how I benefited from it, which he does not recognize, except for the fact that nothing was ever really going to happen to him had he gotten caught, because he was the superintendent's son. Right. This kid could have punched somebody in the face in the middle of the class, and he would have had like a day or two away from school and been back.
Yeah.
Like, you know all that was loaded in there. They use it as the setup for him getting access to the records, but he doesn't use it to go, hey, Dad, by the way, the principal keeps like canning my fellow students.
Well, that's where there's a similarity in both movies, where like they both have somebody they could go to that ultimately would help them. And like, yeah, his dad does totally come through in the end and is like, you're fired. Like, this is, education is for everyone. And like, but there's this distrust, this super distrust of authority figures, where it's just like, yeah, why aren't you going to your dad and being like, look at all these records, look at what's happening here.
I mean, you have the ability within that point to kind of blow up the system from inside. I understand, and we've talked about another high school movie podcast, so teenagers live the secret life that adults don't know about.
Which is definitely happening in this movie.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, if I have a problem with that, it's not only that he can't advocate, but like, this kid, he's attractive. He is privileged. He's the son of the superintendent
who bought them. He has parents who bought him all of his equipment to do his
radio show. He's well spoken. It's really hard to buy this kid is the as the rebel who can't fit in, because he,
I mean, I guess he has really bad social anxiety, which I can sort of buy into.
I will say, my first semester when I was at Klein Oak, I didn't talk to anybody for the entire first semester.
I think the new kid. Yeah. I think that's the one thing, is the new kid, because, you know, he's very popular now. I mean, you don't. There's no sequel to this movie, but, you know.
I think that it also does a horrible job. Horrible. Of, he says who he is.
Well, that over, I want to talk about this. This is a huge structural problem with the movie, because, he literally gets on the radio and he's like, I just moved here from New York. I'm like, how many kids go to this school that just, one kid that just moved here from New York is like, you can't figure out who this kid is.
They even have a Facebook in, the old term of Facebook, in the newspaper of the new students. And Nora is doing, and
there's circling.
So there's a really interesting thing Stuart pointed out to me when we were buying the blackjack gum together in celebration of us doing this movie. He's like, there's this whole Superman element to the movie.
Yeah, it's a very Clark Kent-y thing.
Oh, that's the glasses. Yeah.
She's doing the investigation. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing of like her drawing in the paper in the Superman movie, drawing glasses on Superman.
That's good.
I didn't think about that. Yeah.
He's totally Clark Kenning it up.
Both movies are essentially superhero movies.
And he doesn't make eye contact and sticks his hand in his pocket. Suddenly nobody can recognize him.
Right.
Well, I guess they don't see him doing
the
radio.
He says where he eats lunch and what he does while he's...
apparently she's the only person who listens to that, because she does show up there.
Yeah.
There's some bad police work in both of these movies.
Right? Yes.
But she figures this out pretty quickly. Even the principal's like, somebody knows who it is, but yet you guys aren't doing the work. Like, you are doing... The principal and the local police are doing terrible detective work on this. It's like, you could have gone at any time. He's got a P.O. box.
Right, I know, right? And she shows up there and is like, here's my letter, and I wrote you a poem, and I know what's inside
this crime
like,
is solved in a day.
Yes.
If somebody has the wherewithal to go stake out the post office box.
Yeah. Or walk down the stairs.
Or walk down
lunch.
The stairs during lunch.
Yeah. Like, nobody was
or
like,
look
oh,
at
yeah.
The,
I
the records and see who is the one kid or two who moved from New York City this year and who's the new kid.
And part of it is, too, though, I mean, I can see where he would want to out himself, at least to the kids, by you would see why he would want to do that. Here I've got the most popular show on campus, you know, I am a star,
and
nobody knows who I
am,
you know, nobody, literally nobody knows who I am. I thought it was, the other thing I thought was unexplored is, why isn't he, there's this lucrative tape selling thing.
Right.
You're not getting a cut. Yeah, you're not getting a cut.
He seems like...
would have tipped his hand, man.
At the same time, he seems like afraid of the success. Like he's really not... he doesn't have any way to handle the success. So, and that's part of his coming into his own
agency. They could have gone
down
this whole Superman path. Oh, I know him. Yeah. I could introduce you. Or I could, right. I could like get you a special photo op with him or something. You know, it's right. like they never go down that path.
I will say, like, so I started blogging in 2003, mm-hmm. and the first time somebody who you don't know comments on a blog post...
it kind of weirds you out, right?
Yeah. So, early on, I had written a blog post about the Star Wars Christmas album from, like, the early 80s, mm-hmm. and Mecco himself showed up complaining about George Lucas in my comments, and it was un-frickin' nerving. And anytime, like, mm-hmm. you and I would have, like, comic authors pop up, because mm-hmm. this is back when there weren't that many blogs mm-hmm. or social media. Facebook didn't exist yet.
Right. Well, I think we all had blogs, so we've had
Yeah, blogs. And it is absolutely makes you want to just shut everything down, because yes. you suddenly realize I am exposed. All this stuff I thought I was just throwing into the air is being seen.
When I had a tech blog, I had, like, technology CEO guys commenting on my blog, and I'm like, oh, I thought nobody was reading this.
People can see this.
Yeah.
It's different from stage fright, mm-hmm. but it is nonetheless a... yeah.
Which he like does.
People say,
that.
I feel
seen
now.
That, oh, shut this down. Like, everybody's listening to this. Yeah. I can't do this anymore. Mm-hmm. He has that tension.
Yeah. I think that...
and that is real. That does feel real.
Well, I'll talk about the soundtrack a little bit just because it's amazing.
It's a great soundtrack.
And I love Leonard Cohen, and I appreciate bringing up the Leonard Cohen.
Mm-hmm. When they're highlighting his the not great, like, at the time it wasn't considered the greatest part of his...
right, it's not super popular hits.
It's not his super popular hits, including like the If It Be His Will uh-huh. is off the same album that Hallelujah uh-huh. is off of.
But
Hallelujah,
not the hit.
Yeah, but not...
even Hallelujah wasn't really a hit until they started covering it,
yeah,
right?
So it's like, these are out-of-the-way Leonard Cohen albums that he's uh-huh. that they're highlighting, and that's the first thing I took away from this movie. It's like, who is that?
Right.
Who, you know, but there's a bunch of stuff on here.
Yes,
earlier, like, I feel like this wasn't the time in my life where I was super music conscious. But this could have been a gateway for so many kids who saw this movie. It's got Sonic Youth. It's got an early Soundgarden hit. Mm-hmm. It's got
Pixies.
The Pixies. Great
Ice
Pixies.
Tea.
Like, yeah, Ice-T. This is one of the best soundtracks of the 90s.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. It also has a Beastie Boys track that in the movie, which is not on the tape, which has never actually been released, as I understand it, just on bootlegs.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, he says this is a Beastie Boys track that was too much for the first album.
It's like his bootleg that he's playing. Yeah. I do think Christian Slater is way too cool to actually be a high school student in this movie. This is one of those movies where you're like, yes, I buy the, like, but his taste level and, like, I mean, I'm sorry, like, I think college I buy it a little bit more than high school. But
so I will say this: when I moved to Klein Oak, people have way worse taste in music than when I was at Westwood.
He knew, like, that's what I remember about Ryan, is like, he knows all this weird shit that I had never heard of. Like, that's the first thing I remember about music.
Well, then maybe it was just our high school.
If you think about Eric, too, probably what he was up to when at Westwood.
He was way into, he's older, so he got to experience, and he has feelings about this movie and the music in it, which he has, like, mentioned on Facebook, and he's like, oh, why am I down here? Sorry, Eric, I'm not doing it justice, but... but because he was, like, a certain age in the 90s, like, he got to see shows that would, like, blow your mind. Because he was in Austin, and he was, like, an adult.
Yeah, that was the thing, is Austin was a small town. And so if you were in high school, you went to campus, and you went through the tape racks alongside all of the college kids back then. That doesn't happen. I mean, one, there's no record stores on the drag anymore. But back then, there were, like, four of them. Mm-hmm. And that was what we did on the weekend.
Is still there, I think.
Yeah, it's not where we went.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
It was like, there was like a Hastings on the drag. Anyway, point being, between my brother and his friends, mm-hmm. and my brother's friends had fathers who were faculty at UT, who they were on campus and hanging out and bringing all that stuff back. Plus, you would go to the Chronicle every week and see what was playing.
Right.
So, there was this really, like, you were just mainlining what was going on out there. Like, I
but were you
was
listening
crushed.
To deep cuts Leonard Cohen?
I knew who Leonard Cohen was at
the time. I did too, but like, yeah. Were you like...
Not Leonard Cohen, but a bunch of stuff you're not cool enough to know. I don't honestly remember too much of what I was
That's
listening
just like
to.
Your
at
opinion,
the...
man. Yeah. Go ahead.
But I mean, I remember like, you know, Pixies to me felt like maybe the mainstream song mm-hmm. on this.
Which, no, it, yeah.
And because Pixies were pretty big. At
Pixies, I believe. More...
I was 2 to 3 years away from learning about all these bands, but yeah. I saw the movie. It was like felt like a lost opportunity for me. This was a movie that was like that could have been a cool older brother for me, yeah. and I didn't treat it that way when I saw it. And so right. it's like it feels like something that, but it's also interesting because this movie comes before. The year that punk broke, right? This
yeah.
is like 2 years before 1992, which is the year that that became ubiquitous, you know, and before Kurt Cobain,
mm-hmm. but then,
which was the very real, like, we all went to the same high school. Mm-hmm. Remember what it was like? It was night and day.
Yes.
Like, 1 minute it was Vanilla Ice, mm-hmm. and the next minute it was flannel shirts everywhere.
Yeah.
It was it was just instant. And
why I think still think you guys are posers.
Thanks.
I'm not going to deny it. I remember seeing a smattering of kids who were like in Cure shirts yeah. or Jesus and Mary Chain when I was in middle school,
yeah.
but that was not the norm.
Mm-hmm. And I just think even bringing in like the Ice-T-ness of it all, like there's like
a pulling from a lot of different... I saw Ice-T when I was 16. I drove the first Lollapalooza, man. I saw a Body Count.
Yes.
I am
Which
street
but what
cred,
year was
man.
That?
I was cool.
But what year was that?
That was 1990.
Was it? Mm-hmm. I thought it was more like
No,
91.
It was 90. It was 91, because 90 was after my freshman year. It was after my sophomore year. But, I mean, I knew Ice-T from Power.
Okay.
We were listening to that at basketball camp and going, these are dirty words. Speaking of, hip-hop is definitely used in this movie in an interesting way.
It is.
Whenever the white kids are really starting to rebel, they're starting to feel it.
Vanilla.
To show the crusty old vice principal show up and go, turn this off! Turn off this noise! Which I loved.
So this last time I watched it, I noticed this line on the bus, which I loved, where this guy's like handing off this tape. It's totally like background. I don't think I was supposed to pick it up. But this guy's like got this tape and he's talking to this girl and he's like, I got this tape. It's the coolest thing ever. And he's like, and the girl's like, great. He plays Ice-T and talks about his dick. Like, that's where I'm at in this movie.
This is one of the... So a way that this movie is very different than Legend of Billie Jean,
yeah.
it's not very gendered. Like, these are both girls and boys are listening to this
mm-hmm.
and enjoying it. And I'm like, why? Why wouldn't the girls just be talking with one another? Why aren't they doing, it didn't feel real to me. That,
I didn't buy into, that felt sort of male-gazy. Like, I didn't buy into that the girls would be like, he makes sounds like he's masturbating. It's the best thing ever.
Right.
Like, that part I'd just be like, and even the little teacher was like,
just jack off multiple times a night? And
I'm like, it's not that funny. Like, that part, like, other parts are compelling, but like, that
Because all the girls we know who like the Jerky Boys, right?
Right, yeah. Yes.
I don't, it's like that did not feel right to me.
Yeah.
And even, like, look, I, like, as a recovering cool girl who, like, at the height of my, like, nothing offends me, mm-hmm. you know, now everything offends me. But, like, I would be like, I don't know, like, there's Tenacious D funny, but I'm just like, that's just, it seems like what you get through to listen to the other stuff, not like they're like, oh, that's the best.
These did not seem like the rap songs that the girls would be into necessarily, and I could be wrong, but that's where the girls get butt naked.
I mean, I will say, I knew some girls at Westwood who were into stuff that girls, was not finding my Nora at Klein Oak who was into that stuff.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like I knew girls that were into rap.
I knew, there was one girl I knew that I had a huge crush on at our school.
Name names!
Who was...
I don't remember
I had a huge crush on her. If you're out there,
yeah, me too.
If you're
she
out
rode
there,
my bus.
Oh man, I thought she was the cutest. But
oh,
then she turned out to be a huge rap fan, and like basically, I remember that all the times I saw her, she was with like three other black dudes, and I was like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, I don't, you know, it was like one of those weird cross culture things. Like, I clearly do not know anything about your life,
right?
You know, but she was great. She was. I just thought she was cute as hell.
Yeah.
So she's. That was
I don't
one,
know if
at least
I'm remembering
one
the right person.
Yeah.
But we'll have to pull out a yearbook later and tell me about it.
They're upstairs. We'll go.
Okay, I haven't seen a yearbook in years.
So anyway, the musical thing was interesting to me because it really felt to me very much like getting from Westwood to Klein Oak, where mm-hmm. it was like, oh, you listen to The Cure, you're so edgy. And I was like,
this is like the beginning. This is like pretty far back from the cliff's edge, guys.
Yeah. Like, it's like, I like The Cure too, but... And anyway, I don't want to start bashing on the Klein Oak music.
You can, but it's fair. So
it gets to the heart of how music is very... With the music that you're into is one of the first ways you find out who's cool. And one of the first ways you express your identity in high school. That's the first time I remember Violent Femmes with somebody playing this song. Like, you're going to... This song, you know, is a very, you know, Garden State kind of thing. Where it's like, this song's going to change your life. Mm-hmm. And, like, and I did. I'd never heard that before.
Yeah.
This, a love letter to cassettes. Like, this song works great as a mixtape.
Much better than High Fidelity in a lot of ways to me. Which I... Yeah. We'll go down that path one day. Sorry, I know I just defended everybody.
It is like that, though. I mean, this movie's is like High Fidelity before High Fidelity. Very, very much written with a case like, I get to write a movie about these songs.
Right. I liked High Fidelity, so we'll argue about that another time.
I did too. That's another one. Yeah, I can.
We should talk about the media. I just want to point out Shep Shepherd, because I like that both people have an alliterative name.
Yes.
Even though I can't remember what it is. Jimmy John, Jeffrey's not, still not his name.
Yeah, there was this kind of skepticism of this like detached irony that we all had as Gen Xers about the media and how things were presented, and I thought this movie captured it. This movie also...
I am much less personally anti-media than these movies are.
Do you think these movies are anti-media?
I think
mainstream local news.
I think Pump Up the Volume is when they in the way that they portray Shepherd and how he's just so excited. And when the guy kills himself, and then the guy goes, when then Christian Slater's character Mark goes on the air and is like, "Yeah, why aren't we all like? Sometimes it's harder to be a teenager. It's easier to be dead than be a teenager and be a, whatever he says." And he's like, "Oh, great, he's making it worse." Like, I don't think that's a very favorable.
I mean, if you
think
about...
It's sort of an ambulance chaser, but...
If you think about how the JonBenet Ramsey case was covered, that gives you an idea of what media actually was like around this era. It was very vulture-ish of, we've got this tragedy around wealthy people that has a kind of a question mark after it, and we're going to follow it up. I do think it would have played out exactly like this had there been a radio personality who had been somehow involved with someone's suicide, because everyone, this is the PMRC era, parents would have freaked out and come down on it this way. I think now we'd see parents fighting on mommy blogs about this.
Yes. Actually, you can still go to a parent teacher, like you could probably go to certain PTA or like school board meetings and have a blow up just like this.
Yeah.
It's because
over vaccinated children
of metal
or
music
whatever.
Or
And I think that all of that rang very true, both with, you know, while it was cartoonish how the media was portrayed and how they would have handled it. The thing that rang very false was the head of the FCC, you know, Mr. Wolfman or whatever. He was Scott, what's his name's dad, and Teen Wolf.
Yes, right.
showing up in a limo.
Bo Bridges look
like. That is the FCC. The FCC doesn't have money for limos to be showing up and hanging out at like 10 p.m. in Paradise.
Branded
Hills,
vans.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then he seems to go from like reasonable to like the worst guy ever, like real fast, I feel like.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think he's a politician. And I'm like, FCC people aren't actually usually that much of a politician. And they certainly aren't going into the field to deal with a single case. Like, they're dispatching things from D.C. They're a little busy. I hate the Paige storyline. I hate it.
Me too.
There's nothing...
I don't relate to it.
But a supportive dad trying to help his daughter get into Yale.
Okay, not for that reason, Mr. Like, I... Whatever. This was like the Pretty in Pink argument. Like, identify with the worst character in the movie.
Why is she sitting around listening to this guy's weird tales of masturbation? I just don't...
I believe that.
I didn't find her that compelling. And
there's nothing compelling about her.
It might be the actress's fault. Like, I think if you have, like... I don't know. I think if you have Molly Ringwald in that role...
Yeah.
And why did what?
Why does Slater have a crush on her?
Remember, he totally does.
This weird
thing. Does. He's not into Poetry Girl at all.
Yeah.
Like, he's not into Nora when she keeps approaching him.
Big mistake. Big mistake.
It's like he settles for her because he can't get this other girl to talk to him. Like, why is he into her at all? She's boring.
I know.
But she has that dance she does
outside
the school.
She does the dance and she's pretty, I guess. But
she's
like,
into his stuff.
She's not that into... Is she into his stuff?
Yeah.
Well, she's listening.
Well, I guess
she's listening,
but he doesn't know that.
No.
Yeah.
But why does she stick everything in the microwave and blow it up? And why is she so mad about going to Yale?
I mean, I get... That's the thing, too. Like, I totally get... you're putting too much pressure on me. I want to be this whole other person. I think there's... I think that storyline could work, but it did not work here.
No. It was absolutely hollow. And it, you know, that kind of coding of, or shorthand of, like, you understand what this is. We don't actually have to do this story. And we are watching it as 40-something adults. And now I'm
even
like,
at the time,
you should be thankful your dad's putting all this effort into you.
I mean, he is kind of gross and, like, I don't know.
Is he?
He's in that way that he's like, I don't know why you listen to the radio. You have that meeting with Yale in the morning.
He doesn't say it mean at all. He's like, you have a meeting with Yale in the morning. You should be freshened up. Good night, baby. He shuts the door. Like,
I think it's probably somewhere between our two portrayals.
He's like smiling and chipper.
Why do we need her when we already have the kid who is in a similar situation? Mm-hmm. You see the mom come in. She's mm-hmm. put together.
Good point.
He seems like another well-to-do kid who's clearly struggling and his parents aren't even tuned into mm-hmm. it. Like that.
Fine, have it your
that's
way.
That's the turning cold. Point of the whole... But you don't need two of those.
No, yeah. I know.
Yeah, I don't know.
And when she comes in the PTA meeting, it's not that compelling.
Uh-uh.
When Nora's like, thumbs up to you, Paige, I don't really care.
Well, and then she's like dancing badly again on top of the limo. Like, they should have really gotten this woman some... Like, here's how to at least dance convincingly, Paige.
That I don't mind, just because everybody... there's a lot of dance against movie. I'm like, alright, that was the 90s. That was 1990.
Yeah.
It's a very Dead Poets Society, except nobody ever... Like, that's the movie I kept thinking about while watching this, was Dead Poets Society, where it, with Christian Slater as the Robin Williams.
As the Robin Williams character.
So, when I was in college in film school, we were taught from... and I know some people are going to lose their minds hearing this word, but there's Marxist film theory, and that was where my teachers were coming from. And one of the movies we watched was indeed Dead Poets Society. And... one of the things my teacher did to challenge us as students was say, what are these kids rebelling against? Could you put it? And we all kind of, you know, gave kind of soft, squishy answers. And then she said, so are they, what is the actual rebellion act that takes place at the end? And, you know, I was like, well, you know, they're telling their parents to piss off, you know, what we see in the movie. And she gave what she believed to be a very challenging answer, which was, no, this is not it. My question to her that I've never let go of after 20-something years, obviously, is, okay, what do you think would have been the appropriate finale to this movie? Because if you're saying it's wrong, then there's a right. Or there's no story here at all, right. And why did we just watch this movie? Thanks for wasting the past week of my life. And I don't think it's a terrible question to say or to kind of pose that. But I think it also, the movie never really tackles it, because it can't, because it's for teenagers.
What is it supposed to tackle? What is it?
Exactly.
I think
what is the actual rebellion that these kids at the end are supposed to be doing? And they do this thing of, oh, they're all going to go to Radio Shack. And it's like...
And they're going to create their own podcast.
Every parent in this country is going to be looking for their kid to have, you know, $300 worth of Radio Shack equipment mm-hmm. in their bedrooms now. Like... he could get away with it because he had this basement that apparently his parents were never going to visit, except right. for
that one time.
That one time
when they creepily are really excited that he's going to get laid.
Yeah, yeah.
I think that's the important question, though, is because they're clearly rebelling against something, right? Slater's character, but all of these kids are rebelling against something, and it's not the same thing that's going on in The Legend of Billie Jean, where she's worried about her $608.
Well, they tack on this school thing, but that's not affecting
it's
85%.
Well, it affects Nora, and it does affect that first kid that we know has listened to the program since day one.
Yeah.
I mean, it is affecting some of the kids.
But is that going to get all the kids... I mean, I think what appeals to the kids more is he says at the end, which is not helpful, the teachers don't have the answers.
Right.
You know, and it's like...
That's actually,
where I get
they're
back
doing the work for you in the background while you're just on the radio.
He gets back to kind of... He's kind of
jerking
this proto-libertarian
off. Right.
Of like, we're going to do it all on our own by somehow taking to the radio and yelling at each other.
Right.
But it is... It's a Horizons thing. So they're looking at their parents and they're saying... this is what we're doing this all for,
yeah. mm-hmm.
so that we can take your place one day in the suburb doing nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's, I think that's the, and I think that's at the heart of the Dead Poets Society, too, is chafing against the expectations of mm-hmm. this is why you go to school, and this is your defined path.
So
and
you then, have
and
to
I think
be.
That's why that one character, why our pretty princess character is in there, is because the idea that they are their chart your own course, mm-hmm. which is literally what the pirate radio is a metaphor for, mm-hmm. is why am I accepting the media that you're giving to me? Why am I accepting the pathway that you're giving to me, the education that you're giving to me? Why not do my own thing? That's what they're doing. And I think that's the same thing that's at the heart of Dead Poets. And every teen angst movie
right.
is this is your defined path, but I want to go down a different course.
And it's that kid finding his own... Sorry, we're also a podcast about Dead Poets Society. Mm-hmm. But it's like that, finding your own agency and your own voice, yeah. right?
I didn't agree essentially with my teacher. Right. Because at the end of the day, I agree with what you guys are saying. It doesn't necessarily appeal to me as a 44-year-old who kind of knows the way shit works. But it did appeal to me when I was 15, and I do feel it was helpful to me in at least going, okay, there's a program and you don't necessarily need to be on it. And if nothing else, that worked for me pretty well.
Yeah.
But I don't know.
This kid has a ton of privilege that Billie Jean does not have.
Yeah.
And Billie Jean is just trying to make it through, mm-hmm. you know? And like, yeah, I mean, I think she asked for the $608 because she does not have bigger dreams than that. And then, you know, the kid who has like the $608 worth of stereo equipment in his basement, like, and is like, but my parents sold out.
Yeah.
You know, it's just, he has a lot of privilege that we don't have to feel sorry
for. I like how the mom is just sitting there drinking her white wine and dressed like she's going somewhere
all the time.
Yeah.
But we don't know where she's.
Yeah.
And she's just annoyed all the time. And that's Dharma's mom and Dharma and Greg, too. I had to say that because it was bugging me. Oh, can I also say the principal is Annie Ross
from Superman Hendrix 3. That's where you're going. Superman 3.
Superman 3, too.
She becomes the cyborg at the end of the movie.
Oh, yes, that. I haven't watched that. Again, I mean, I've watched it, but I haven't rewatched it since you last mentioned
that. You just
saw
a lot of judgment going on.
You mentioned that, and then we were talking about something, and I was supposed to watch it, but I haven't rewatched it. But she's also a jazz singer.
But yeah, I did like how she really was, like, chewing the scenery in mm-hmm. this. Yeah, I was like, I'm going to be the crustiest, crusty principal you've ever seen.
But even, like, watching it, too, everything she says is, like, so jazz singery. We're going to get those boys. What I'm doing is not illegal. I'm like, I actually respect her a lot more under that, knowing that. She's in her office just smoking and running things.
There is a way that both these movies sort of touch on and hint at things. And I think, like I say, weirdly, even though it's a worse movie, it's a much more thematically rich movie. The Legend of Billie Jean, where there's a big... if you're going to talk about Marxism and mm-hmm. Marxist theory in terms of being a critique of capitalism, that's a big theme of Legend of Billie Jean, and it seems like it should be a bigger one in Pump Up the Volume in terms of, you know, the there's not a lot of class stuff
right.
that is in there, but it seems like it could be.
It's why I thought the principal storyline was all tacked on as an afterthought of like, oh crap, like they said he needs to actually right. have a nemesis, but we already have the storyline about a guy who has a radio show who accidentally causes a suicide, and what's the fallout from that? And like, aha, we'll tie Nora in right. to this because she's going to get kicked out in the third act, which launches him into action.
I mean, it is kind of in there from the beginning because he does go to his dad. There's a whole thing about what his dad does. He does go find that letter for Cheryl. Mm-hmm. It's in the very beginning when the kids are coming off the bus.
It gives Ellen Green something to do, who they for some reason hired Ellen Green for this movie. Mm-hmm. Again, didn't get to sing, jazz singer.
I know.
But we don't, you know what we don't see in Pump Up the Volume, and there's a reason for this. I did some internet research. Not a lot of cars.
Oh, yeah. There's a good story behind that.
There's a good story behind that. Because Christian Slater had his second DUI and was not allowed to drive.
And I think that might have been the one where he led the police on a car chase and, like, finished it, like... running into a pole or something.
Exactly.
It wasn't just like I was drinking a little.
Yeah, it was like he had a car crash. It was an embarrassing DUI. Mm-hmm. And I remember. I mean, that was in the news.
Yeah.
Well, he wasn't able to drive during the movie. They couldn't even show him driving because he was not allowed to drive. And of course, they're filming it on location mm-hmm. in this area where you would be driving on city streets. Mm-hmm. So they got around that. And that's one of the ways that movies, especially teen movies, like to communicate status, right? Mm-hmm. Is what kind of car is each character driving, mm-hmm. and they avoid that whole thing.
So except for at the end, even though
right.
they show him, he's somehow gotten there with his mom's Jeep,
Mm-hmm. But why then, his mom would have a Jeep. That day's car does not.
Because the mom is still wants to be a hippie, even though she's sitting around drinking her white wine.
I mean, actually, this all rings true.
I'm going to drink white wine. But be
this is like the precursor to the SVU. Right. Or SVU.
Yeah.
But she... And then the guy drives around on the hills. Yeah.
We're getting back to iced tea right now.
That was my first casting job as an intern.
Yeah, that's
me. Were you responsible for getting iced tea on that show?
Yes, that's what they put the interns in charge of.
Wait, call iced tea.
Oh, God.
Get Coco on the phone.
No. But he's got to drive around. They have to have the open air. He's got to drive around the hills. And she has to drive because he can't. In the actual scene.
Yeah, I did appreciate seeing a kid who knew how to solder.
That warmed
my heart.
Yeah, some soldering porn that's thrown right in there. I like
that. Making it happen, Laura. Yeah.
this kid's good with his hands.
I've soldered before, and I gotta say.
Did you have music over it?
Maybe that was what I was missing. Actually, yes, because we were in a scene shop where there was always music. But
yeah, you were making it happen.
Well, that didn't get me as excited, I guess.
This movie launched like a million tape op subscriptions, you know? Home radio recording.
Well, that was good. So back to my own personal story. We did not do, because we'd read how illegal this was. So we were, you know, watching it as kind of this fantasy fulfillment of, oh, this kid would have gotten shut down in week two, as well as knowing, you know, stuff again with like the phones within 1,200 feet. Mm-hmm. It's like, how many high school kids really live in 1,200 feet?
The detective work is poor. Also, it was weird the way they shot that, where they're like naked on what I think is the back porch, and then they look across to like somebody's front yard.
I'm just going to be topless out here, y'all.
And I was like, that's a choice.
Mm-hmm. Did you want to talk about the surprise moves?
Oh, you guys can talk about it.
It was a surprise and one when I was 15.
Yes.
We get nudity in this movie?
Yeah.
I guess all I would say is it's so weird and awkward. I mean, it's not, it's just the way it's presented is like, he takes off his shirt while he's doing the show, comes out, and then he says, we're so different. And her answer is, but I'll take off my shirt too.
Yes, we are.
She's like, oh, we're not that different. I'm clothed and you're not, so I'll take off my shirt.
I did read that scene as, because they do set it up as, she's having a hard time getting him to talk to her and to overcome the barrier. Mm-hmm. And I think she does that to feel vulnerable and to communicate vulnerability.
But she's
like
not
that.
Well, look, it's hot, I guess, but it's like also...
She made a bad choice with the sweater. She's steaming up there.
Yeah, why are you wearing a sweater in Arizona?
Because it's got to be like October here.
Yeah.
And I tell you, it's hot in Arizona in October. It does bring up... This was a rated R movie aimed at teens. Mm-hmm. Back when theaters, apparently... I mean, I went and saw rated R movies in the theater. I looked a little older than I was, and I wandered into it. But rated R movies for teens were a thing at this point, and now you can't get anyone to make a rated R movie to save their life. If you were to try and remake this now...
so many reasons you could.
I think you'd get a PG-13.
This would be on Netflix now.
Yeah, with the boobs. Yeah. I think you could do it.
Yeah. I haven't watched much of like Pen 15 or any of those shows. I don't really know what they're getting away with, but I know since it's called Pen 15, they're probably getting away with talking about a lot of things.
I don't think we see a lot of boobs.
I also would be curious to see, because they'd probably now gender flip it one way or another.
I didn't have a problem with the scene, but it you know, obviously, I for real didn't have a problem with it when I was 15. She's super cute and surprise boobs and it's wonderful, but it also didn't feel just tacked on either. Like, because from what I could see, I thought it would be.
I think when
she knows he's like a horny dude too, so like in characters, like she knows like this is the one thing he thinks about all the time.
I don't know that she's going for vulnerability. I would more believe that she's going just to try and get a reaction out of him.
Yeah,
like
she's trying to get him to talk. Yeah,
she's not like, vulnerable. She's like the talky one. She's the main.
Well, that's what he says. You're so confident.
But she goes for his crotch. Because she's like, let's see the cock ring or whatever. Yeah. Like, and he's like, no.
Yeah.
And he's the one that puts the like.
Yeah, that's very believable of like a high school dude of like, oh no, a woman being sexually aggressive.
But
oh, God.
I don't really want. Yeah. Not really interested in doing this.
Yeah, yeah. Which I don't know how I read it when I was 15. I don't really remember. But now as an adult, I'm like, oh yeah,
The kids walking through the hall. What's a cock ring?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's a ring with a cock on it. But then he's wearing it.
I
love this conversation. This is like, we needed to.
Yeah.
That is funny.
Yeah, and I'm sure this is how I knew what a cock ring was from this movie.
This is definitely my first introduction to the notion of a cock. I was like, what do you do with that? I don't even know what that is. Yeah.
Anyway, this is now about an hour and 45 minutes.
Cock rings.
Cock rings.
And so we're going to end on cock rings. I think that seems appropriate. Any final thoughts? Anything you guys want to head into next? I know there was some sci-fi stuff getting thrown around on the Slack.
No, I'm stuck on cock rings now.
Okay.
I do feel like the high school kids getting together to talk about teen movies, we might be running out of compelling teen movies.
No way! There's so many.
So many more.
And then there's even the ones that, like, maybe we don't like. And
yeah.
The ones I suggested were the space wish fulfillment movies,
yeah.
Of which there are many around this time, and I love the mid-80s, and I didn't get to say it, but The Legend of Billie Jean is a great 80s movie. If you want to know what the 80s are like,
yeah, that movie without an L.A. Sheen.
It felt very, very real. Like, if you're in a mall in Weird Science, that feels like it's an area for rich kids.
Yeah.
In reality, the malls were where middle class and poor kids went to feel like rich kids.
Mm-hmm.
And that was when you see the Joskies, when you see the way, like, you see, like,
it was a real
bag and baggage. This is like a real mall in the 80s with, like, G.I. Joe toys. It was very much I live in consumer culture and this is what I see around me.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it felt very real. And if you want to revisit 1985 again, this is the movie to do it.
Because the mall was such a huge thing. Yeah, and then getting the rights to shoot.
In Texas.
Yeah.
But yeah, anyway, we'll be back soon with more high school movies.
And maybe some Last Starfighter and Space Camp.
Yeah.
We had four thrown out there.
Yeah, Kids go to space for for various reasons. We'll maybe explore kids going into space.
Yeah.
It's a rich and fertile ground. Yeah. And
would be
nice to visit that.
And Kate Capshaw. She's in Space Camp.
Oh.
All right. We're gonna end on that. Kate Capshaw.
And Kate Capshaw.
Way to kill the bug.
About wraps it up for this edition of The Signal Watch, a production of The League of Melbotus. Thanks for sticking with us. If you enjoyed this podcast, we invite you to drop on by the Signal Watch blog, where you'll find write-ups of a wide variety of movies and more. You can drop comments on this podcast and let us know what you think. We do have a Signal Watch Patreon, and if you're so moved, we'd most certainly appreciate your support. We'll be back soon with more exceedingly high-quality content. So, until next time. God damn it, babies. You've got to be kind.